The Old Testament books of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy were written 3,500 years ago by Moses. He wrote them in the Hebrew language. As Western Gentile Christians that speak English, we do not have the benefit of reading those five books in their original language. And we miss a tremendous amount of a special message that God has in his Hebrew language and Hebrew alphabet. Now Moses took one letter, the Nun, the 14th letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and he turned it around backwards in one passage in the book of Numbers, chapter 10, verses 35 and 36, and he used it, the Nun. It looks sort of like a bracket in our English. And he used it, he turned it around backwards, two of them, to bracket off two verses right in the heart of the book of Numbers. And we want to talk about these backward noons, for this is the only time in the entire Bible this has been done. Why did God allow it? What is the meaning behind it? I think it is a profound meaning. And Gary Stearman is here to discuss with me High Noon.
High
Noon. I guess
noon.
That's the best way to put
well,
it.
Well, yeah, and it is a very high exalted letter, J.R., High Noon. Noon is a letter that has an unusual spiritual significance, J.R. It's a letter that, according to Jewish expositors, symbolizes faithfulness, soul, and emergence. And it's the initial letter of the word Ne'er, which means lamp. And they liken the lamp to the soul.
Yes.
And so there's a transcendent quality to this letter that makes it very, very special indeed. It speaks of the man of faith as he goes through the redemptive process and finally emerges standing straight and tall before the Lord. So it really is the letter that we might associate with redemption.
With fall and redemption, don't you think?
Exactly.
Which is, by the way, the story of the entire Bible.
Yes, it is.
This is the key, this is the theme of all of history, of all of mankind. Adam was made, he fell, and God has redeemed him, and is in the process of redeeming Adam's descendants until that great day when the Messiah comes to set up the kingdom. So this noon is a profound letter, but fascinating to me, Gary, that right here, and let me just show it here, and we'll get a close-up on the camera. Right here is a noon, but it's backwards.
Mm-hmm.
At the beginning of verse 35 mm-hmm. of Numbers chapter 10, and following verse 36, so there's two verses in bracketed here,
mm-hmm.
another reversed noon.
That's right.
What did the rabbi say about this many centuries ago?
Well, those reversed noons, J.R., are, I should open by saying, and we should have mentioned this a minute ago, but noon stands for downfall and rising again, metaphorically. And it is the initial letter of the Hebrew word nephila, which means to fall. But such is the theology of the sages of Israel. They say that man is never allowed to fall mm-hmm. Without God picking him up again. So it's called the letter of downfall and rising again. As we said a minute ago, that's the story of redemption. Now this reversed nun that you just pointed to is the symbol of Israel's downfall, quickly reversed with the support of God. In other words, Israel is never allowed to fall down without God's support quickly mm-hmm. coming to hand.
Yes. The noon representing rebellion and fall is quickly followed by the samach, which represents preservation
exactly.
and redemption.
Exactly.
But now this verse, these two verses, verses 35 and 36 in the book of Numbers, chapter 10, divides the book. It literally divides the book. In fact, these two backward noons, bracketing these two verses, the rabbi said, means that these two verses in themselves represent another book, a separate book.
Hmm.
Now I want to read these two verses. And it came to pass when the ark set forward that Moses said, "Rise up, Lord, and let thine enemies be scattered, and let them that hate thee flee before thee." And when it rested, he said, "Return, O Lord, unto the many thousands of Israel." Now, if you can imagine the Shekinah glory above the Ark of the Covenant, as it is placed upon the shoulders of the Kohathites, the Levitical order chosen to carry the Ark, and it goes out away from the camp of Israel, out in front of them, as the camp of Israel marches behind the Ark, and they follow the Ark. That's what the verses here are about, and someone has suggested that the glory of God turned around backwards and looked with favor upon Israel, but I think these backward noons mean more than that. Of course, now the noon here represents the Ner, which is the lamp, or the Shekinah glory of God.
Shekinah glory. Mm-hmm.
And it's fascinating to me, Gary, that this is separate, because in the first 10 chapters of Numbers, we have simply the order.
Let me read a quote from Rabbi Michael Monk, who has cataloged the meanings of the Hebrew letters, and I'm quoting this. He says, the reverse nun was chosen, that is, in the book of Numbers, for it is a symbol that the nation's downfall, generally denoted by nun for nephilah, Hebrew word meaning downfall, will be reversed by God as soon as Israel returns again and adheres to the holy ark. So, J.R., what we have here is the people turning away, basically, from God. But they are promised redemption as soon as they turn back to the Holy Ark. Well, the Holy Ark is a symbol of the glory of God, the presence of His Holy Spirit, the tables of His commandments, the manna.
Yeah, the marriage contract.
The marriage contract and Aaron's rod that budded, by the way, which is a symbol of God's grace, and the almond rod and all of the symbols of that. So turning to the Holy Ark means basically having your faith restored. And it's very interesting to me that at Numbers 10:36, the final verse of Numbers chapter 10, there's a sudden turn in the book of Numbers. Mm-hmm. A 180 degree turn, if you will, just like the letter Nun, it just turned around.
Yes. For you see, beginning with chapter 11, verse 1, everything deteriorates. The people begin to complain. They begin to fall into troubles. Mm-hmm. Right up through the first 10 chapters of Numbers, we have the order of everything. We have the guiding cloud. We have the candlestick in chapter 8 and so on. But when we get down to chapter 10 and verse 11, it says, it came to pass on the 20th day of the second month in the second year that the cloud was taken up from off the tabernacle of the testimony. So you see here the Shekinah lifts. And the children of Israel took their journeys out of the wilderness of Sinai. In other words, they left Mount Sinai. Yeah. They left where God had given them the commandments. And they moved out into the wilderness. They are soon to approach Kadesh Barnea in chapter 14 and the debacle of not believing the spies. And before we get to that, in chapter 11, we've got, listen to verse 1, and when the people complained, it displeased the Lord. So you see, we've got everything turning from good to bad right here with this little bracketed two verses in between, which to me represents three books in the book of Numbers. Mm-hmm. And by the way, you know, we have five books, right? Five books in the Torah.
Yes.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. But if you take this bracketed verse, as the rabbi suggested centuries ago, and make it a book of its own, even though it's two verses long, we have the first 10 chapters of Numbers as a book. We have from chapters 11 through 36, as a book, and we have these two verses as a book. That's seven books, Gary. Seven books.
It is.
That's a menorah design, taking the five books of the Torah and making them into seven all of a sudden.
Now, we didn't just pull this out of the air, because it was Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi who said that this passage is so significant that it deserves to be taken from its context and appear in Torah as an independent book. The inverted nuns, he said, serve to isolate this passage and set it off as a book all unto itself. So really, Numbers then becomes three books, just
yes,
as you said.
Yes. So what we've got is seven books of the Torah, which include these two bracketed verses, you see, bracketed by taking the letter Nun and turning it around backwards at the beginning of verse 35 and at the conclusion of verse 36. So what we've got here is, let's start over here, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers 1 through 10, Numbers 10, 35, and 36, and then this lamp would represent Numbers 11 through chapter 36, and finally Deuteronomy. We have a seven-branched menorah design in the five books of the Torah.
And look what's at the center. The center is the first division of Numbers, which is a book of organization and of order and sanctification. Everything is being done according to the order of the Lord.
Plus, in chapter 8, that's in these first 10 chapters,
yes,
we have the story of the candlesticks.
We sure do.
And the Lord spake unto Moses in verse 1, verse 2, speak unto Aaron and say, when thou lightest the lamps of the seven lamps, shall give light over against the candlestick, and so on. He goes on to describe it.
There it is.
So right at the servant lamp in Numbers, the first 10 chapters of Numbers, we have the lampstand.
It's amazing how these things work out. Now, you may have difficulty following all the details, but to repeat again, what we have here is a system. It's a system of wisdom that has been passed down generation upon generation, which says that numbered groups of things, for example, the five books of Moses, are not just a serial number, like 1 through 5, but rather are a structure.
Yes.
So you have five, Genesis through Deuteronomy, which is a five-lamp menorah, now divided into seven. And these structures, J.R., speak of the redemptive work of God, in fact, which is the very meaning of the letter Nun. Now, we're not through, because we can divide this up into yet another menorah, which we've come to call on these programs the menorah of grace, the Hanukkah menorah.
The nine-lamp menorah.
Yeah.
And this is what is so fascinating about it, because when you add Joshua and Judges to these seven divisions of the Torah, you get nine divisions, a nine-lamp menorah, in which case, these two verses that are bracketed with a noon that has been turned around backwards, two of them, it becomes the servant lamp. And the noon stands for Ner, the lamp of God. The Ner Elohim, the lamp of God. And what we have in these two verses certainly speak of the servant lamp, so to speak, because it centers upon the Ark of the Covenant. And when we take Joshua and Judges and add them to these books, we're adding grace and the millennial reign of Christ.
That's right.
And the very name Joshua, of course, Yeshua, happens to be the Old Testament name for who we call Jesus.
That's right. And Numbers 10, 35, and 36 appear at the exact center of this nine-branched menorah of grace, which includes Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, the three divisions of Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges. Such a beautiful picture, again, of the redemptive work of God.
Yes.
It all began when God created man. Man fell. He was in need of a redeemer. God arranged for a redeemer and held man up again. This is the subject of the letter Nun.
Now, the Nun is not a stranger to the servant lamp, because the Nun represents the 14th letter of the alphabet. And there are 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet, plus five final letters, making a total of 27. So this 14th letter is the center letter of the 27 forms of the Hebrew alphabet. So it, again, is a servant lamp of the entire alphabet, once you add the last five Sophit letters, or final forms, which, by the way, speak of grace.
They do.
So you've got to add the whole picture before you get to this final conclusion that the Nun, the letter Nun, is a servant lamp. Furthermore, it is the middle letter of the five Sophit letters of Kaf, Mem, Nun, Peh, and Zadi. These five Hebrew letters make a menorah in themselves. These five letters have two ways of writing them. One is called the form of the letter, and the other a final form, or in the Hebrew it's called Sophit, a Sophit form, if that letter is found at the end of a word. It is written differently than if it is found somewhere in the middle of a word, in the spelling of the word. So we've got Nun here as a primary source of the servant lamp of the menorah design.
And you know, J.R., I think we ought to wrap up by saying this. We're not pulling this out of the air. In fact, there is so much that we can't tell you because we don't have the time. But let it be sufficient to say that in our studies, we know, for example, that the prophet Jeremiah understood the meanings of the Hebrew letters because we've studied Lamentations, which is an acrostic that includes all the verses arranged according to the Hebrew alphabet, giving the meanings of each letter. We know that Moses, through God, knew the meanings of these letters because the Torah is full of this, the Torah being the first five books of our Bible. We know also that the psalmists, including David, understood this perfectly well. I'm thinking of Psalm 145 right now, which has 21 verses.
And those not 22?
Not 22.
Only 21?
Only 21.
Wow.
Guess which letter's left out?
Tell us.
The letter Nun is left out of Psalm 145. Nun.
In other words, the first verse of Psalm 145 starts with an olive.
With an olive.
The second verse starts with a bay.
That's right.
It's alphabetic all the way through.
Yeah.
To the very final tav,
the last letter,
except the Nun is left out.
The Nun is missing, which means this psalm only has 21 verses. And guess where the Nun should have appeared? Of course, at verse 14, which reads, "The Lord upholdeth all that fall, and raiseth up all those that are bowed down." Now, J.R., that's incredible.
Oh, my, that speaks of the bent Nun and the Sophit Nun.
It does.
The bent Nun shows a man on his knees in humility.
Yes.
And the straightened Nun shows his final salvation and standing before God in glory.
And David left out the Nun because he wanted Psalm 145 to be a psalm of the praise of the power of God. It's the only psalm in the whole series of psalms that is called a psalm of praise. It's a complete praise of God's upholding work.
It's the final praise, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Because Psalms 146 through 150, the last five psalms are actually a recapping of the book. So Psalm 145 is the grand finale just preceding the Hallelujah Chorus.
Amen.
and so it rests upon a great final conclusion here, the redemption of Israel. And in the last 5 minutes we have, Gary, before we go to a little announcement, let's discuss the 14th book of the Old Testament, 14th being the 14th division of the 22 divisions in the first to the third centuries, which would be the book of Psalms. So the letter Nun stands for the book of Psalms, which, by the way, we discussed in our book called The Mystery of the Menorah and the Hebrew Alphabet. When we came to this Nun, we discussed the Psalms here as representing the Nun. And we see in the Psalms the rising again of Israel.
That's right.
The redemption of Israel. So right from Numbers 10, 35, and 36, from that point forward, we've got this, the fall and the immediate lifting up and the support and finally the rising again of Israel.
Now, we have in the word Nun an interesting event, too. In Aramaic, the word Nun, Aramaic being one of the dialects of Hebrew, of course, Jesus spoke Aramaic, the word Nun means fish. And a fish is symbolic of the productiveness of faith, that is, the faith of man. And even the early church used the fish as its symbol, which I find amazing.
For redemption.
For redemption, yeah.
And salvation.
Isn't that fascinating?
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. So what we have here then is the Nun represents the Psalms, and the Psalms tell the story of the redemption of Israel. And then in the New Testament, the book of 2 Thessalonians is depicted, it being the 14th book of the New Testament, is depicted by the noon. And 2 Thessalonians is the one that tells us of the final redemption when the Lord will come. It's the second coming of Christ in power and great glory to destroy the wicked.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, 2 Thessalonians really defines the day of the Lord and the reward of the righteous who looks for the return of Christ. And to me, what a tremendous theme to be lodged in the value of noon.
Yeah. And then, of course, in Revelation chapter 14, we have the noon chapter, and that's the chapter where we have the 144,000 standing on the Temple Mount, Mount Zion, with the Lamb of God in their midst. Isn't that incredible,
mm-hmm.
Gary?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want to ask you a question, Gary.
Okay.
Why did Moses use the noon here to bracket these two verses and not one of the other letters of the 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet?
Well, J.R., there's a long answer and a short answer. The short answer is because the letter noon contains all of the elements of the redemption and the support of God, so that it symbolizes not just downfall, nephilah, but rising again. It symbolizes not a failure of faith, but also the return of faith. And guess what is set apart? The beautiful passage concerning the Ark of God, set apart by noons. Mm-hmm. This is the support or the presence of God in His glory before the people.
Rabbi Monk wrote concerning the soul,
yeah,
which, of course, the noon stands for soul. He says, the soul is a heavenly spark housed in an earthly container. So this represents the Shekinah glory of God. Bracketing this verse is the glory. And, you know, when the sun is directly overhead at high noon, the sun represents this noon, doesn't it?
It does.
We even call it noon, folks. That's incredible.
Well, an amazing coincidence. You know, we should say this, too. The letter noon represents the number 50.
Yes.
Isn't that interesting? 50 being the number of Jubilee, that is, when everything is said and done, right, when the kingdom comes in and God has done all His redeeming work, you come to the number 50.
And it's the servant lamp of the 100.
Yeah.
Of the 100 increments of the numbers. And then, of course, don't forget, the Ark of the Covenant has been returned to Jerusalem. Soon it will be set up on the Temple Mount when the Jews restored temple worship, and that's got to be a noon. Wow. It looks like maybe the noon's going to be turned back around.